Welcome to the sharing of God's word today. It's a blessing to share this with you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning. Thank you for the honor and the privilege of having to hear your word. Thank you for the honor and the privilege of receiving instructions, counsel, and wisdom from you, Father, that by which we shall live, that by which we live. For man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. I pray this morning, Father, let light illuminate us. Our hearts and minds be illuminated by your light, even as your word comes through this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's always a joy to share with you the word of the Lord. And this morning, I want to pick up from where we stopped last week. We are talking about bringing order in our finances, divine order in our finances. And I do not want to give this more of an economic perspective, as it were. I'm trying to bring it more to a spiritual angle and bring the spiritual order in our finances. All life is spiritual. Life begins in the spirit realm, and if we get it right in the spirit, everything else will fall into place. And today, as we talk about order in finances, I want to talk about the relation between work and money and the right attitude towards work. But before I do that, let me quickly link up with the last session, just in case you missed it out. In the last session, as you pursue the thought on the right attitude towards money and wealth, we say that everything material that God entrusts to us is for an eternal purpose. Everything that God entrusts to us, everything material that God commits to us, everything material that God places in our hands, in our custody, in our care, everything material that God entrusts to us is for an eternal purpose. He equips us for his name's sake. It is for a spiritual purpose that material wealth is entrusted to us by God, and not for self-profiling, self-preservation, self-promotion, and self-satisfaction. If I can make you grasp that in your heart and mind, that God does not give you wealth, does not give you money, does not give you material resources for self-profiling, self-preservation, self-promotion, and self-satisfaction, then my heart will find peace and rejoice. God makes us rich so that he can use us to enrich others. He makes us a blessing. He blesses us so that we can be a blessing. It is not for ourselves, as it were, not for selfish ambitions and selfish desires. We did say that your attitude and approach towards money points to the condition of your heart. Your attitude and approach towards money points to the condition of your heart. Firstly, it points to the issues of trust. Issues of trust, where your trust is and what your fears are. Secondly, it points to issues of identity. Do you operate as an orphan or as a son of God? What mindset rules you? Thirdly, it points to issues of priority. Priority. What is at the top of your mind? Is it the kingdom or is it money? Is it God or is it mammon? All right? Is it the worship, honor, praise, and glory of God or self-preservation? What is at the top of your mind? That's priority. Fourthly, it points to issues of worship. Who are you loyal to? Who do you serve? Who do you ascribe honor to? And lastly, we said it points to issues of lordship. Who governs you? Who motivates you? What motivates you? Right? That issue of lordship. The location of finances will tell you the location of your heart. If you want to know where your heart is, follow your money. The Bible says where the treasure is, there the heart will be also. We concluded with a recap of the two-part introduction and said that one, your attitude and approach to finances can propel or curtail your spiritual progress. Now, this was the gist of what we were saying in that twofold or two-part introduction. Your attitude and approach to finances can propel or curtail your spiritual progress. Secondly, money and wealth should be looked at and handled in view of eternity. Do not separate your attitude towards money from eternity. You must look at it from an eternal perspective to understand how to handle money, which is temporal. And so how do you handle it while you are in this temporal life? Thirdly, we said there are biblical principles governing finances for a child of God, and we ought to live by them. These are things we must understand. So we have to learn to view money from God's perspective. We must develop the right attitude towards money. Now, once your attitude towards money has been adjusted and fine-tuned to fit in God's divine agenda, you now begin to administrate your money in view of God's purpose. The kingdom of God now becomes your priority. The kingdom becomes your priority. God's purpose, God's will, God's agenda, God's rule, God's reign becomes your priority. You no longer live for your own. You no longer live your life seeking after things, but rather after the rule and reign of God. You live to do the will of God. This is the context of Matthew 6:33. And it says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you." We like quoting this scripture, but we don't take time to look at it in its context. Now, the whole chapter is about putting faith in God and having the right attitude towards money. The whole chapter is a question of where do you put your trust in? What are you concerned about? What concerns you most? All right? Where is your heart? What concerns you most? Where to place your trust and where to invest? Those two things are very clear in these scriptures. It brings out the idea of two perspectives, two perceptions, two masters. It's very clear. Two masters, you either serve God and mammon, two perspectives, a bad eye or a good eye, darkness or light, and two treasuries, heaven or earth. Now that is very clear in Matthew chapter number 6. And so the Lord Jesus was teaching his disciples how to live in compliance to the design of God for life. In the whole of Matthew chapter number 6, the Lord is teaching his disciples. He's teaching people how to live their life right in the light of the design that God has ordained for life. A life of faith in God and not a life of worry and anxiety. That's the kind of life, brothers and sisters, that we must live. A life of faith in God and not a life of worry and anxiety. Money should not take you from God, but rather actually help you come closer to God as you use it to serve the purposes of God. God is concerned about how every of his children generates and administrates their money. I've said this again, and I'll keep saying until it gets into our spirits. God is concerned about how every of his children makes and spends, makes and uses, generates and administrates their money. That's why we say there are biblical principles governing finances for a child of God, and you do well to know these principles and to live by them. Now, the process of generating and administration of money, making and management of money, that process must have the kingdom of God as a priority. Whether it is in the making or in the spending, whether it is in the generation or administration, in the management of finances, that priority must be the kingdom of God. In the making and spending, you must be governed by the rule of God in your life. The principles of the kingdom must govern how you make money and govern how you spend money. It must govern where you make money from and must govern where you spend your money. Principles of the kingdom of God. Now, the consideration of the kingdom of God, that's God's righteous rule, God's reign, God's authority. The consideration of the kingdom of God should be the guiding principle. God desires that we recognize, receive, submit to, and advance his rightful rule and reign on earth. God desires that we discern his kingdom, we discern his rule, we submit to his rule, and we commit ourselves to advance his rule, that is his dominion over all things. So whether it is in the making of money, the kingdom of God must be advanced. Whether it is in the spending of money, the kingdom of God must be advanced. Whether it is in the making or the spending of money, the rule of God must be put at the front of all things. The reign of God, the dominion of God must preoccupy you. Brothers and sisters, whether it is in the making of money or in the spending of money, the will of God must be at the very core of the decisions that you make. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Now, God's design and intention is that by applying this principle of his kingdom first, you will access an inexhaustible and eternal dimension and then activate a supernatural supply source from where all things will be added to you. That's the whole essence of Matthew 6:33. That as you put the rule of God into the front of your mind, as the dominion of God, the reign of God, the rule of God, the advancement of God's agenda on earth becomes your priority, as you give yourself to pursue that as a priority, then you access an inexhaustible eternal dimension. Because you see, the eternal dimension is inexhaustible. And I dare you, not many people have known this dimension. Not many people have accessed this dimension. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. Not many people have said, God, there is an eternal dimension. God has an inexhaustible resource center. Now you access this inexhaustible eternal dimension. And in this dimension now, you activate a spiritual supply source from where all things now are added. Brothers and sisters, it is possible to access this dimension and enjoy endless supernatural supply from the Heavenly Father. Oh, glory to God in the highest. Let me give an example of Elijah and the Zarephath widow. In 1 Kings chapter 17, 1 Kings chapter 17, and I'll read from verse 12 to 16, says, "So she said, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin, and a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." And Elijah said to her, "Do not fear. Go and do as you have said, but make me a small cake from it first, and bring it to me, and afterward make some of yourself and make some for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord God of Israel." Now Elijah is connecting this woman to the eternal, inexhaustible dimension. He's now connecting her to the supernatural supply source through the word of God. It is through the word of God, in the receiving, in the hearing, and the applying of God's word in our lives, that we access this inexhaustible eternal dimension and activate the supernatural supply source. He says, "For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on earth." So she went away and did according to the word of Elijah. And she and he and her, that is the woman Elijah and her household, ate for many days. Hallelujah. Now watch the next one. It says, "The bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke to Elijah." Now, what happens here? This woman is given a word of the Lord. She has only a handful of flour in a bin. She wants to make these, eat with her son, and then die. But God has sent to her a man of God to preserve. God has sent to her a prophet to preserve, a prophet to feed, a prophet to take care of. And then what happens? The prophet now knows the only way to connect what she has to eternity is through the word of the Lord. And the prophet accesses the heart of God. And the prophet speaks for the heart of God to this woman. And when he speaks the word of the Lord, the woman believes the word of God. The woman takes the word of God and obeys the word of God. And upon obeying the word of God, what happens? The bean of flour was never used up. Nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. You can access an inexhaustible eternal dimension. You can unlock a supernatural supply of resources. It is possible, brothers and sisters. But I wanted to see the principle the woman applies. The advancement of God's purpose, the advancement of God's agenda, the kingdom of God becomes a priority. At that particular time, God's will, God's purpose, God's intents in Israel are being pronounced, proclaimed, and propagated and advanced through this man, Elijah. So in supporting this man, the woman is connecting to God's purpose, agenda, intention, intent, rule, and domain. Dominion rather. And so the woman is putting the kingdom of God as a priority. And she decides to first of all invest in the kingdom. Hallelujah. What happens in putting the kingdom first? Everything was added to her. She unlocked a supernatural supply source. And this woman never lacked. There is an example again of Elisha and the widow who had two sons and they were about to be sold. The husband had passed on. And she looks out, she cries out to Elisha. She's about to be auctioned. And Elisha gives her a word. Tells her, you go and borrow jars from your neighbors. Lock yourself with your sons and begin to pour the oil. As she does that, as long as there was an empty jar, what happened? As long as there was an empty jar, there was supply. The law of demand and supply. You see, when you put the word into action, you are placing a demand on God. And when you place a demand on God, there will always be a supply. We must learn to come to the point where we administrate money in accordance to the word of the Lord. All right? The Bible says in Romans 8, 31 and 32. Romans 8, 31 and 32. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Amen. All things. He can. He is willing. We must find a way of how to access this inexhaustible eternal dimension and activate a supernatural supply source. God can do it, brothers and sisters. God is our source. He is Jehovah El Shaddai, the all-sufficient one. So if you think your job is your source, you have missed the point. You can work and not get paid. Yeah, you just work and for whatever reason your boss doesn't pay you 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. You can work but get a 50% cut. Right now in this season where COVID-19 has hit the earth so hard, people are losing their jobs. Salaries are being scaled down, some up to the point of 50% cut. So if your job was your source, what happens then? How do you live? You can work and be dismissed. So what will you do? You see, when such negative things happen, stress and depression comes because we had all along defined our source in the wrong way. We all along had the wrong source. Our job was the source. And so when you lose your job, when your job goes down, or for whatever reason happens that's to do with your job, then you feel like the world has come to an end because that was your source. Now, I need to state here that I believe in working. And I believe that God does expect you to work. It is our attitude towards work that is the problem. Our vocation has been elevated to become our God. It has been elevated to the position of God himself. It is now our sustenance. It is now our source of livelihood. Work began before the fall, brothers and sisters. So work in itself is not bad. It is actually a means of worship to God. Work is spiritual. But how you handle work is very important. Work is spiritual. You read it throughout the Bible and you see how God connects work to spiritual whatever. He was telling the children of Israel, as you take care of the poor, as you take care of the orphans, as you take care of those without families. He says, I will bless the work of your hands. As you take care of the priests among you and the Levites among you, I'll bless the work of your hands. All right? As you do this and do that, all which has got to do with the spiritual sacrifice and worship, he says, I will bless the work of your hands. So work is spiritual, and it is connected to what how we treat the things of God. Work is meant to draw you closer to God and not draw you away from God. It's unfortunate today that work has drawn many people away from God and away even from their own families. Men and women are preoccupied with making money. They have become the money-making machines. They are always looking out on how to make money. A man has lost control of his family, his wife and children. There is too much he doesn't know about her, too much he doesn't know about him. And so, I mean, about the children. And so what happens? There are quarrels all along, and he thinks they don't understand him. The wife has lost control of her own children, of her own husband, and she thinks he doesn't understand her, and the children don't understand her. Why? Because she is giving all she is thinking she has given herself to pursue and make money. So money has taken you away from your family. Money has taken you away from God. Money has taken you away from what matters the most. Your job has taken you away from what matters the most. Work has taken you. Work has come between you and God. Work has taken control of you. You can tell God no, but you cannot tell your boss no. You honor, respect, and fear your boss more. You have more value and regard for your work than you have for God. These things happen, brothers and sisters. It should not be so. It ought not to be so. Work must be viewed in the light of God's purpose. Work must be viewed in the light of God's purpose. Work is meant to draw you closer to God and not draw you away from God. Work was begun by God, and God began work for a purpose that I'll be telling you in a few minutes. So yes, I believe in work, and I believe in working hard. I believe in hard working. I believe in working and hard working. And I do know that God expects you to work also. Let me validate these scriptures. Genesis 2:15. Genesis 2:15. Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to tend and keep it. All right, that's work. So when God created man before the fall, God put man to work. Deuteronomy 28:12. The Lord God will open to you his good treasures, the heavens to give the rain to your land in its season, and to bless all the work of your hands. You shall lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow. Now, I want you to see that God is opening the heaven and blessing the work of your hands. So if you're not working, what will he bless? Right? You have got to learn to work. And he says you shall lend to many nations. To become a lender, not a borrower, you must become a worker. You must become a worker. That's what is important, to have the right attitude towards work. That's why it is important to understand the place of work. Praise the name of the Lord. Proverbs 22:29. Do you see a man who excels in his work? He will stand before kings. He will not stand before unknown men. If you want to stand before kings, you've got to be diligent. That's in your Bible. A man who is diligent in his business, in his work, he will stand before kings. So learn to work and work hard. Yes, but now there's a difference between working hard and becoming a workaholic. Those are two different things. Working hard and become. Some people use work just to be away from their families. Some people use work just to hide from God. It becomes an excuse. Now work has become the fig leaves that we hide with. It was not meant to be so, brothers and sisters. And you see, if you don't have the right attitude towards work, you cannot have the right attitude towards money. That's why I'm addressing this before we go to the administration of money. Proverbs 6:6. Proverbs 6:6. It says, go to the ant, you sluggard, you lazy person, who does not like getting tired. Go to an ant. Consider her ways and be wise. It says, go and learn from an ant. See how active, see how diligent it is. The same portion of scripture, if you can read further down there, you will see talking about that if you are lazy and all you do is sleeping and you love sleeping, you become poor. And by the way, if you love sleeping, you better be ready to be poor. Because work demands that you sacrifice your sleep. 2 Thessalonians 3:10. 2 Thessalonians 3:10. I'll read up to 12. It says, for even when we were with you, we commanded you this, If anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. For we hear that there are some who walk among you in a disorderly manner, not working at all, but are busy bodies. So if you don't work and you're a busy body, that's disorder. It says, now those who are such as we command, now those who are as such, we command and exhort through our Lord Jesus Christ that they work in quietness and eat their own bread. Why? If anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. You don't work, you don't eat. So God expects you to work and to work diligently. However, brothers and sisters, your work, your occupation, job, business, or whatever you do, your vocation, this work is your God-given platform to advance His kingdom, but not your source of livelihood. God does not give you a job as a source of livelihood. It's an environment for you to reveal Him, to manifest His nature and His rule. God expects you to work, and He has determined that you eat from what you work on. Now, please hear this and keep it in your mind. I am not saying that we don't work, and I am not saying that we don't get anything from our work. This is it. God expects you to work, and He has determined, He has ordered it that such that He has organized it in such a way that you eat from what you work on. It says, you shall not muzzle the mouth of an ox as it treads the grain. So as the oxen treads the grain, brothers and sisters, the oxen will eat of the grain. Very important. So what you work on is what you feed from. That is not something made up by men. That is made up by God. Right in Genesis, God puts man in the garden. God provides all the trees for man to eat from except one. And then God tells the man, tend the garden and keep it. In other words, cultivate it, take care of it. God ensures that there is water coming from underneath, replenishing everything. So man is working on the trees from which he is eating. So God intended that man works, and where he works and what he works on feeds the man. That's God's system. That's what I'm saying. He is the source. The trees were not the source, but the giver of the trees was the source. It is God who gave the trees. It is God who gives Adam the wisdom, the energy, the capacity, the ability to work on the trees. And guess what? It is God who makes the trees productive. Blessed be the name of the Lord. If God is not involved in your life, brothers and sisters, you will not be productive. You will not be effective. You will not be successful. You will not prevail. But when God is involved with you, when you look at Him as your source, the source of strength, wisdom, energy, and sustenance, that God will give you all that you need to be productive in your work, and that work will become that which you feed from. And so in the making or generation of finances, God expects you to earn justly by working. He says, if you don't work, you don't eat. You eat the fruit of the tree you work on. So God expects you to eat from what you work on. All right? So how do you generate money? How do you make money? By working justly. Are we together? Now, what you receive from your just work, whether you call it salary or remuneration or allowance, becomes the fruit of your labor. All right? Fruit of your labor. And then you begin to enjoy the fruit of your labor as the right attitude towards work. Thus, work becomes, number one, a God-given platform for a son of God to showcase the grace, wisdom, and glory of his heavenly Father. It's a platform to advance God's kingdom agenda. So your job, your vocation, your work is a God-given platform to advance God's agenda. Number two, work becomes, number two, a God-given platform to serve. So God gives you work so that you can serve. God wants you healthy. God wants you to serve. You are created to serve. Jesus said, I did not come to be served. I came to serve. So God wants you to serve. So what does He do? He gives you a job to do. He gives you work, not a job. He gives you work to do. Now, God does not give us jobs. God gives us work, right? And God does not tell us to go looking for a job. He tells us to work. So even when you get a job, it is that you can work. That you can work. Because that work is worship. So work becomes a God-given platform to serve. God wants you to serve, brothers and sisters. Whatever you're working, whether in the farm, in the factory, in the office, have a mindset of a servant. I am here to serve. Number three, a God-given environment to build you. All right? God wants to build you up. So he gives an environment within which to work. And in working, you get built up. In working, you get edified. In working, you learn. In working, you learn. Are we together? Number four, work becomes a God-given environment for you to express yourself in the giftings of God within you. It becomes a God-given environment for you to express out the gifts for you, the gifts that God has put in you. Are you together? God has put in you talents. God has given you gifts. God has given you abilities. So he gives you a platform, an environment where you can make use of the gifts that he has given you. So work becomes a God-given environment for you to make use of the gifts that he has given you. Gifts here talking of talents and abilities. And lastly, work becomes a God-given opportunity and means to generate fruit for sustenance. God-given opportunity and means to generate fruit for sustenance. Now, for you to only look at work as a place to generate food and sustenance, just to give you income, it is too shallow. You miss the bigger picture. It's a God-given platform to advance his agenda, to advance. What a privilege. God wants to work together with you. It's an opportunity to co-work with God and advance his mind, his will, his desire, his intents. Hallelujah. It's a privilege to co-work with God and reveal him among men in that environment. It's a platform to serve God and to serve his people. It is a platform for you to be built up and be edified and to increase in wisdom and understanding in knowledge and your character being molded and your foolishness being confronted and your laziness being confronted and become a wiser man. It's an environment for you to make use of the gifts in you, the talents in you, the capacities, the abilities in you. You make use of them where you're working. It's a God-given opportunity and a means to generate fruit for sustenance. This is the right attitude towards work. It's a God-given platform for a divine purpose. Amen? And so this work must draw you closer to God. Work should draw you closer to God and not far from God. It is therefore important, brothers and sisters, to know how God has wired you and what he has configured you to do and where he wants you to operate from. You must know his platform for you. Some of us may be struggling today because we are wrongly placed. Reminds me of a day one time I was in a Sunday service, finally gotten the right attitude towards work. So find work and do. Find work and do. When we started homeschooling our children, my wife stopped everything. And my wife has been the one who has been taking care of these children, educating them and taking them through the system. All right? I've seen her waking up and taking care of them and make sure they have breakfast, make sure they have lunch, make sure they have supper at the same time. Go through their classwork, make sure they are reading, make sure they are learning, scoring all their work. And you know, right now, as we talk, the girl has finished her grade up to grade 12, went to university. She has finished now. The boy is just about to finish his grade 12, his advanced grades, and go on to university. My wife has been working. People never saw her leave the house. And so they thought she's not working, but that's the work. And because of working, she glorified God. Because of working, she advanced the kingdom of God. These children were now placed on kingdom principles and values. She served the children. She served me. It became an environment for her to be built. She was built up. She made use of the gift in her. She's very patient with the children, very good with the children, not like me. And so she worked on. She generated her own income. God rewarded her. God blessed her. God ensured she never lacked anything she needed. Why? Because she worked. So find work to do. There's work all around you. Find work to do. Find work to do. The wealth of the wicked is not transferred to the righteous on a silver platter. You have to work. We like saying that the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. This does not happen blindly. The wealth of the wicked is not transferred to the righteous on a silver platter. You don't sleep and wake up one morning and find, pop, the wealth of the wicked has been transferred to you. You must work. The wealth gets transferred as you work. If you don't work, you don't have faith. You are lazy and you should not eat, because faith is expressed also in working. Lazy people are poor managers of money, and God will not entrust riches to them. You see why God wants you to work before you can have money? It is so that when you learn how to handle work and administrate work and how to receive instructions, authority, and all these things, then you know how to handle money. You can use money. If your view of work is right, then your view of money is right. If your work is connected to God's purpose, then your money is connected to God's purpose. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And that way, God will entrust you with more. God gives you what you can handle, not what you ask. And there is no better place, brothers and sisters, that you can be taught how to handle some of these things than in a work environment. So how should you work? As I begin to wrap up, how should you work? Work justly. Work justly. You can see that in Proverbs 28 verse 8. Work justly. Proverbs 28 verse 8. Number two, work diligently. Proverbs chapter 6 verse 6 to 11. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 6 to 11, and then Proverbs 22, verse 29. All right? So work justly. Do not be dishonest in your work. Be truthful. Be sincere. Work diligently. Don't be lazy. Number three, work faithfully. How should you work? Work faithfully. Work faithfully. Ephesians 6, verse 5 to 8. Don't work like the others are working. You work faithfully. You be faithful. You be faithful to God and to man. Be faithful. Work faithfully. Praise the name of the Lord. Do what is expected of you when it is expected of you. Work faithfully. Number four, work joyfully. Hallelujah. Do not work murmuring. Work joyfully. Don't complain. Philippians chapter 2, verse 14 to 16. Philippians 2, 14 to 16. When you're complaining about your job, complaining about your work you're doing, you are cursing your own job, you are cursing your own work, you are murmuring, you are placing limitations on yourself. Do not complain and murmur in your work. Work joyfully. Hallelujah. Number five, lastly, work as unto the Lord. This to me is the foundation of all the rest. Work as unto the Lord. Colossians chapter 3 and verse number 17. Colossians 3 verse number 17 and verse number 22 to 24. Colossians 3, 17 and then 22 to 24. So consider work as worship to the Lord. Consider it as an opportunity to represent Him and not an opportunity for self-enrichment and making of money. Work as unto the Lord. This is how you generate income. This is how you make money. This is the right attitude towards work. This is how you work. Work justly, work diligently, work faithfully, work joyfully, work as unto the Lord. God intends for you to enjoy the fruit of your labor, yes. God intends for you to enjoy the fruit of your labor. But you must labor for there to be fruit. This fruit of your labor must be managed with great discretion and in accordance to the biblical principles, but not with anxiety, dishonesty, murmuring, and utter disregard of the biblical principles. The fruit you make must be administrated in biblical principles. So plan how to spend it and plan within your means. Once God has given you income, once God has given you money, He gives you power to make wealth. You see that? Power to make wealth. So God has empowered you to bring forth fruit and crop as you work. Once you have this fruit, plan how to spend it and plan within your means. This plan must be guided by the word. We'll be looking at that more. This plan must be guided by the word. Many people live beyond their means, and this is the disorder that has led to one crisis after another. Plan within your means. Don't be unrealistic. Many people live beyond their means, and you could be one of them. You need to repent today and come back to the place God has put you, and then grow progressively. You see, when you have no plan, but you live your life to make a point and satisfy your selfish desires and ambitions, you will end up in debts and bad debts. Because you have no plan. You don't know how to administrate what you have. And you don't know how to, you know, bring your life to the level that you are in right now. Not living like another one. All right? But because you have no plan, you want to prove a point. You want to live like somebody else. You want to impress your wife or impress your husband or impress your parents or impress the villagers and all that. You end up in debts. You end up in bad debts. And that's where many people are today. There's a difference, beloved, between taking a loan as a capital to generate more and borrowing to feed your ego and selfish desires. While one can take a loan for good use and for capital, especially if the Lord leads you to do so. But my issue is, when you're borrowing to feed your ego and your selfish desires, when you're borrowing to fit in the society, now that is foolishness. But let me say this to you today. When you find yourself borrowing to sustain your basics, when you find yourself borrowing to feed your family, to feed yourself, and you are working, when you find yourself borrowing to sustain your basics and you are working, your life and finances are disjointed from divine order. They are out of order and you're on the wrong trajectory. That is not God's intention. You ought not to be borrowing for those basics. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added to you. God is true in that word. All these things shall be added to you. But you must have the right attitude towards money, the right attitude towards work, and you must work in the right way. You must work justly. You must work diligently. We must work faithfully, joyfully, and work as unto the Lord. You must have the right attitude towards work. And as you do this, God will make sure that that which you work on will give you fruit to feed you. That which you work on will feed you. The tree you work on is a tree that feeds you. I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among the sanctified. Till next time, God bless you.